So Power Rangers is many things. I think the premise over the years has changed, but at the core of it, really, it's a story of kids, teenagers, that are from different places, that are brought together by some higher power to help save their world or their universe or their city from alien invasion. I think basically every iteration of Power Rangers somehow fits into that description. What I wanted to do with SPD was create a scenario where the kids had to like kind of rise through the ranks to get the power, that they had to learn how to use it before they had the authority to actually implement the power of being a Power Ranger. The concept I pitched was an academy. In the original footage that we were going off of, it was kind of a police station. They were already in the positions and they had all the gear and everything. I wanted it to be more of a situation where they were in like a school training to be Rangers. And I really wanted my core cast to be the B team, the underdog. You know, I think it's something that all kids, all teenagers, when you're in high school, it doesn't matter if you're the, you know, coolest jock or the head cheerleader or whatever, you all live with this kind of underdog scenario where you feel like somebody's cooler than you, somebody's better than you. And it's part of becoming an adult is to living up to the potential of being everything you can be to actually make the A-team.
The audition process was really fun, actually, and I remember I was a figure skater growing up, and Bruce, the executive producer, was in the audition room with me, and I remember him looking at my resume and looking at my skills and saying, "Oh, you figure skated," and I said, "Yeah," and he's like, "Can you do an axel for me?" And so I remember having to do some fun moves and just to show my athletic ability.
After the dialogue parts, they asked me to move. They said, "We just want to see everybody move. You can do karate, you could do gymnastics." I kind of said I didn't know how to do either. They said, "Then just dance." And I kind of just did a jig, kind of just moved and left going, well, that's not going to happen.
Funny story, they actually passed on me at first. So this is like a little thing for the, yeah. So they passed and I was like, okay, well, that's fine. You know, people, you get passed all the time. And, like 3 weeks later I get a call like, "Oh, they, you're in the mix again." And then I found out I got it. And then I found out I was going to be the Red Ranger. So it kind of all happened really quick.
When I got the call back, there were these great sides. It was Bridge Carson walking into his commander's desk. I did not know that my commander would be a big animatronic talking dog. In the script, you don't know that. You know, he's just like a general who went to battle and the battle was lost. And Bridge comes in and he has this long speech about how the way that they lost is actually how they're going to win. But as I'm even talking right now, and those watching me talk right now are lost in my train of thought, that's how Bridge speaks. So I think I just have an inherent nature to talk about things and then loop it back around. And you're like, oh, now it all makes sense. All those tangents, all those different thoughts he had as he was talking all kind of looped around. And now I kind of understand him. And that was what the speech was like for the audition. And the producer, when he called me, Bruce Kalish, to tell me I got the job, and I said, why did I get the job? He said, "You're the only one where that the dialogue made actual, it made sense the way I said it. Everyone else, it felt like they were stumbling or making each thought a new thought." And that's the secret. You just gotta kind of talk until you have nothing else to say to play Bridge Carson.
Mind if I ask a question?
It's gonna be one of those long, drawn out bridge type questions that really isn't a question but leaves us asking lots of questions.
Wait, I ask long, drawn out questions? Okay. Wouldn't now be a good time to morph?
Yes!
I would say with the characters in SPD, that is probably the one place where I really didn't want to change things up too much. I mean, I think Power Rangers works visually and classically on a very base level that's just perfect. You have your colors and your personalities, and they fuse, and you know who everybody is, you know?
Jack, this is Sky, Bridge, Z, and Sid. It's nice to meet you.
Of course, at the head of any Power Rangers team is the Red Ranger. So that's always like the pin that's stuck right in the board. Like, everything has to grow around this. That's our rock, our center. So we had to go out and find the perfect Red Ranger. And the story we were creating was about a Red Ranger who didn't want the responsibility of being a leader, but knew that if he didn't, things wouldn't work the right way. So it's an act of selflessness in order to unify the team. And we found Brandon, who really embodied everything. Like, Brandon, you can't be cooler than Brandon.
I still talk to Brandon to this day. He's from Vancouver. I live in Vancouver now. He's doing so well, though. I think he's off in Florida shooting. But I see him when I can, and we keep in touch over Twitter and email. And he's just a really nice guy and so talented. But he's a cool guy. Really liked Brandon.
Brandon was the most experienced actor when we started shooting the season. I think we all felt a huge amount of respect and admiration for him. We had all done other little roles in independent films and TV shows, but I think most of the stuff that we had been in, no one had seen, and people had seen his stuff. So he arrived pretty confident and took the job very seriously.
He was just everything we wanted to see in Jack. We wanted Jack to be somebody that all the other guys could admire and aspire to be, and the girls would love him, but you would believe too that he could be like, I'm out of here, and leave. You know, you didn't want him to leave, but you knew at any moment he could. And as a person, that's Brandon.
He was a leader on the show. He was also a leader off the set as well, and really kind of kept us all together and always planned dinners. He loved to wine and dine and, you know, see the city. And so he kept us all together, I think, in the evening and on weekends.
Him and I always discussed different acting techniques and methods and his approach to acting. We would give each other tips. We would talk about the scene to kind of try and get to understand it. And I think if you watch the show, especially Brandon's scenes, he's talking about, you know, Muppets, you know, that we have to take down, but you believe him.
Come on, Sky, play with us.
Light ball. You're kidding. D-level game.
You used to love this game.
No time for games anymore. If you remember, we have an enemy sitting out in space. Grum's not playing games. Neither am I.
Blue Ranger was probably the hardest role to fill just because of the way we saw him fitting into the lineup. We wanted this kind of diehard, by the book, not unlikable, but not warm and fuzzy guy. We wanted someone who was like the drill sergeant, you know? But also someone that wouldn't alienate the audience. It was just a weird combination of things that on paper sounds totally fine. But then you start meeting people and you're like, well, you know, you're too much of a jerk and you're like too like rigid. Like there's, you know, there's no way that you could ever change. And Chris just really had this like kind of likable best friend kind of attitude, but played the whole Iceman thing.
I think if he was how old he is now in the 80s, he would have been cast as that kind of collar-up prepster jock guy. But that's who he is on the outside. Like, when you get to know him on the inside, he's like a sweet puppy, you know? He's more sensitive than I am. And I think that we all got a chance to see that side of him.
Chris is probably the most unlike his character. Chris and Sky could not be any further apart. Chris in real life is the class clown.
He was very loud and kind of crazy, and he loved to have fun. And he and I, you know, like Sydney and his character on the show, we kind of butt heads now and again, but in a fun way. But we would definitely pick at each other, and we had a good relationship.
He cares about his friends like a ton and will be there for you no matter what. He's still there for me like that now. And we don't get to see each other that often. But if I needed him right now, and I called him, he would come over. He's just that kind of guy.
Got it. He's at a junkyard by a river. And I saw the word gold.
Gold's junkyard. Down by the river.
You know, Sky? You are good.
Matt is as funny in real life as he is on the show. His brain moves at a million miles a second. He is a, you know, certifiable genius slash crazy person.
Matt is a sweetheart. He's funny and intelligent, and he's a writer in real life, and he's really great to talk to, and a little bit more low-key than Chris and Brandon, but in a really good way. He was very sincere, and I just really, really took to Matt.
Matt and I are still great friends as well. He's a great guy. He's making films and stuff up in Toronto. I saw him in Miami like 3 or 4 months ago.
If anyone had a massive influence on their written character, it would have been Matt, because he was kind of like the Ringo Starr of SPD. You know, he would just say things and we're like, why did you say that? And then we're like, but we'll write that in the episode. You know, he probably needs residuals and writing credit. I mean, things like buttery, that was just something, he just did that and said that. We're, you know, like, okay, that's your thing now. And walk up to any SPD fan and be like, oh, it's buttery. And they'll go like this, you know?
It's buttery.
Buttery?
Buttery.
Matt had a very good comedic timing and just the subtlety, you know, the little looks and the reactions to things and the pauses that I think really helped sell that character. He wasn't the over-the-top guy. He was the guy that went like that, and it really made you laugh. And he was up for anything in terms of situations, like whatever we could dream up to put Bridge in. Matt would do it, you know, standing on his head to think for, you know, it's like when you watch the show, you're just like, oh, that's funny. He was on his head for like 3 minutes. But it's like when you're filming, like that could have taken 6 hours. And we're like, okay, Matt, back on your head.
This is a pretty good thinking position, don't you think?
Yeah, yeah. I'm actually thinking my arms are starting to hurt real, real bad. And I'm going to need to.
On a side note, we actually did a play while we were shooting Power Rangers in New Zealand, in my apartment. We all wanted to kind of work on something like a little more creative. So while we were shooting Power Rangers, we put up a play in my apartment. And I was in it, Monica was in it, and Matt directed it, and Chris and Alicia produced it.
Ho, ho, ho! Okay, how come I didn't get the memo on the uniforms?
I doubt if that's SPD regulation.
Sid probably dresses up to go to the laundromat.
Right, like I do my own laundry.
Alicia was one of those like Hollywood stories where a girl gets off the bus and some producer sees her and is like, you got moxie, kid, I'm gonna make you a star. You know, it was pretty much that exact scenario. She came in, I believe she was the first person we saw for the wide audition. And we're talking about, this is Power Rangers. We're looking at per cast member, 300, 400 people, you know, some Red Ranger was probably even in the thousands of like headshots that came in, and to narrow it down. She was first one, came in, nailed it. We were just like, that is her. Like, that is Sid.
Alicia's lovely. She just wanna like, you just wanna grab her and like hold her forever. You're like, can I put you in my pocket and take you home? She's awesome.
I wanted to have like the cliche kind of like girl who doesn't care about anything but herself, but at the same time, I didn't want her to be dumb or, you know, naive. I mean, I just wanted her to be like so focused on her agenda that like other things didn't matter. And she really was able to pull that off.
I brought a lot of myself to the role. I played myself up a little bit because Sydney appeared to be a little bit more aloof and ditzy at times. But I think I'm a pretty bubbly person. So I just kind of let that flow naturally into Sydney Drew.
Her and I had a great kind of brotherly, sisterly vibe. I think also because as far as Rangers, we were the Rangers that everyone always underestimated. So I think both Alicia and I like subverting people's expectations of like the kind of people we are.
When the pilot episode premiered, instantly I just got friends calling me going like, oh, I see, you make the blonde girl like the nasty dumb one. I'm like, that's not really what we were trying to do. So we just fine-tuned it to make sure that, you know, went in a different direction, and she carried it all along.
So no one's ever made a fuss over your birthday?
There wasn't a lot of extra money for cake and ice cream where I grew up anyway.
And I kept yammering on about my extravagant party. What a spoiled brat it must have sounded like.
Nah. Okay, maybe a little.
The one thing with Alicia, though, was that she could not sing. So we, in the story, we had it where she was like a huge pop star and, you know, Olympic gold medalist and like just perfect at everything. When it came to the episode where she needed to actually perform a song, it was a disaster. We had voice lessons. We did like everything. I don't know why we just didn't get someone else to sing the song.
What's that record?
It's good, huh?
Yeah.
It's a song that Sid wrote and performs. It's called Me, because it's all about her. You like it?
Seriously, can you bring the blue guy back? Please.
What does he know? He's a lizard.
To this day, people on Ranger Board and stuff ask me for the full lyrics or a copy of the song. It's probably one of the lost treasures. I don't know. You know, it was like a clip came across my desk at one time, and I was like, oh, that's funny. Yeah, totally. I don't know where the whole recording is.
Thank you.
You may not be coming in peacefully, but you're coming in.
What about me?
Huh? Yeah! It's a hologram. It's not real. Okay, she's real.
Monica probably has the best Power Ranger actor story in the history of the franchise. The company wanted to have racial diversity, which is totally normal for a show like this. This particular season, they were like Latina. So then we found Monica, and I guess no one actually asked her what her background was. She looked the part, she played the part, she had the accent, everything. Turns out she's just a really great actor. She faked it all. We didn't know till I'd say fourth or fifth episode, we were like having a discussion about how important it was that she was, you know, the Latino representative in the season. She's like, I'm not Latino, I'm like Irish German. We were like, okay, shh. But at that point, that whole thing had passed.
Monica was a blast. She was so funny, and we were the only two girls, the only two Rangers, so we really had to stick together.
Monica was like the dancer performer of the group. Like, whenever we would go out on the weekends, Monica was always like the life of the party.
She's kind of girly while at the same time, you know, game for any sort of thing that guys want to do.
She is outgoing and daring and in your face and is just not afraid of anything, and she really brought that out in the character.
I got really excited when I first met Monica May because I had never had a love interest on any sort of project I had ever acted in before, and on the first few scripts, it alluded to there might be some sort of romance between Bridge and Z, but there was not. And I think at the very beginning, her and I both thought that there was going to be something going on in the show, so we hung out a lot and tried to flirt, but I don't think we liked each other like that.
I remember in New Zealand where they shot the show, they have high tea and there's carbs galore everywhere, and so I remember Monica and I bonding, going, okay, this has to stop because we have to fit into our spandex uniforms, and if they keep feeding us biscuits and cheese and carbs, like, we're just not going to fit into our uniforms. So we started bringing our own lunches, and we'd sneak into our trailer and just eat healthy, and she was great.
My first day directing Monica, there was a scene where she gets surrounded by the bad guys and has to run away. And that was the moment I realized that Monica didn't know how to run. Here she is, this, you know, super bad chick from the street and a potential Power Ranger. She ran like this. She was like, whoo! And I was like, cut! I'm like, what is happening? And I was like, okay, can we just tell her to like run like more, you know, like run like with purpose and like strongly, you know? It was a terrible direction, you know, but I didn't know, like, what do you say? And so we did the second take. And so I had to pull her aside and be like, okay, when you run, like, I need you, you know, like to run like this. And I actually made her cry, which was terrible. I felt so bad when she was like, she was nervous. It was like the first day, and it was like the first thing I pointed out that was like not working properly. But if you watch later in the season, and then she and I made another movie together where she's an action hero and she runs, and it's like she's like an Olympic gold medalist. She adapted so quickly.
I knew this was too good to last.
Ready! SPD! Emergency!
Another Monica story. First day, we tell all the Rangers, okay, this is your morpher. When you're done with your scene, you're going to give it to the prop guy. And then when you're ready to shoot, he's going to give it back. Do not lose it. Do not destroy it. Do not throw it. Anything. The women's version of the SPD outfits had little skirts and a belt, and their morpher would hook onto the back. Monica takes a break and decides she has to use the restroom. She goes in there. She's trying to work with the costume. The morpher pops off her back. Bloop. Right down the toilet. And it's gone forever. She came out. It was so nervous. Took about 20 minutes before she said anything. And in the end, it was really, really funny. But first day, right off the bat, boom, down the toilet. Morpher number one.
I congratulate you for such noble instincts and exceptional teamwork.
Yes.
But you disobeyed a direct order. The Trubians got what they wanted and now have unobstructed passage into our galaxy. Great battles lay ahead for all of us. You may make fine Rangers one day, but today is not that day. Dismissed.
The whole cast and crew kind of traveled together. We touched down, we put our bags in our room, and before we could even kind of relax, we were brought into wardrobe fittings. They took photos and video of what would become the opening sequence for the show, like within 2 hours of us landing in New Zealand. Which was crazy, because we didn't really even know who our characters were at that point. Every time I see the opening sequence, I cringe a little, because they were like, just now turn around and smile. It's like, all right. And from then, we were bussed over to like a gym. We walked in, and there's like a full-on manga-style Japanese fight going on. Then they stop, and then the lead instructor walks forward and he introduced himself. And he said, I'm going to be your instructor. And it was basically, I'm going to be your instructor now, like, get down and give me 20. And for about 2 weeks, we trained.
We went through a crazy boot camp fighting process.
I was an NCAA Division I soccer player, full scholarship, like I'm an athlete. And that was by far the hardest thing I've ever done. They killed us.
I remember in high school, I was in gymnastics, so I was flexible, but it had been a while since I was doing any gymnastics moves. But they would just get you to do the splits, and they would come behind you and just push your back to the floor. And, you know, so it was a boot camp. But it worked. We learned a lot in that two-week period. I was exhausted. I went for some massages. I think I needed physio on my knees for a while. So it was intense.
Chris was known for being very strong, and Brandon was known for being really quick and agile, and he was in really good shape, so he took to it very well. And I remember when they were kind of assessing what everybody's strengths were in terms of learning the moves, they were, you know, Matt, you are very flexible. Like, flexible? That's the one I get, flexible? Like, you are a fighting demon. I would be afraid if I ever ran into you. He's like, you can touch your toes.
Kia!
Stuntmen and the team out there are incredible. They're like all Jackie Chans, like they're crazy. So we learn from the best. And when I say the best, they were phenomenal.
Koichi and his stunties are they're amazing. I mean, the things that they do, I didn't know was possible for the human body to do. They're such professionals. And we didn't get to do a lot of our own stuff only because there's two units shooting simultaneously. So when they're off shooting stunts, we're doing all the drama. And every once in a while, if I had like a scene off, they would whisk me away to second unit to try to get me in to do some of my own stuff. But you go over there and it's like, they're so much more time efficient because they just do everything in like one take and they got it. And like, I need like 19. And it's like, I'm sorry, guys, you know? So after a while, I'm like, listen, just you guys do it. You're good at it. But they're great. They're fantastic.
They were so nice and always asking us, can we get you anything? Are you okay? And I'm like, forget about me. Are you okay? You're jumping off buildings and doing 10 backflips and rolling over cars, and they were incredible. And my stunt double was actually a man with a blonde wig, and he'd have to get full makeup and put on that wig and my outfit. He was my favorite. He was so talented. And we had the same stature. You know, he was pretty small, but he was the nicest man. He had the cutest family, and they just worked so hard, and they would make sure we understood our choreography, and they were so patient with us, and they're experts, so they don't need, you know, a lot of time to get these scenes down. And for us who were still learning how to fight and the choreography, they were just very patient with us and really thorough with their explanations, and we really bonded. And I miss those guys a lot, you know, and they were just such professionals. It's funny, the hair and makeup team, they had to create all these blonde wigs, and I had very curly hair in the show. And so sometimes my stunt double, he'd do a flip and his wig would be sideways. So I'd maybe get in there and be like, no, I think maybe you should fix your hair a little bit. You know, his part's like down here. other than that, the fighting sequences, I let the professionals handle that because they knew what they were doing.
Rangers reporting, sir!
Rangers, Drybots have broken into the gold depository. You've got to stop them.
Ready! SPD!
They're all my cast was like amazing. They were such great posers, you know? Monica, everybody, like when they just struck that pose, it was like you actually, you didn't even have to CG in the lightning. Like it was real when they did it. And Chris was really good at it. Like he could make the face, the game face we called it, where he would just look at the camera and you're like, whoa, take this guy seriously.
We all kind of came up with our signature moves. Everyone, before we go in and head into fight or morph, we all got to develop our kind of own sort of signature. I had a background in teaching archery, so I tried to make mine this kind of like archer's kind of fighting pose, where in my head, the beginning was like I'm drawing the bow back.
Greg and Bruce are two incredibly talented individuals. They're both so different, but they became family. And to this day, I still talk to both of them. I feel like they really made the experience so wonderful for me. And Bruce, he was a great guider, and he really led us in the right direction when we were there. Didn't let any of this go to our head, kept us on track, but such a nice, supportive man. And you could talk to him about anything. He knew what he was doing. He was the best. And Greg is a talent. The sculptures he creates, and he's so artistic. He really made SPD what it was.
He's a genius. I mean, he's amazing. He thinks in ways that I could never imagine. And the great thing about Greg as well is that he just cared so much about what we were doing. It trickles down. And, you know, when you see the guy at the top who cares so much, it makes you want to care. And everybody around you, the crew, the camera guys, the wardrobe, makeup, you know, he really set a good tone for the entire season.
Doggy is probably the character closest to my heart, only because the actors brought the other characters to life. I got to have a big hand in bringing Doggy Kruger to life.
Commander Kruger, sir, we have a problem in the
Ninth Quadrant. I am aware. Nylandia has been destroyed. There is not a lot of time and much to be done. He is coming.
The concept of Kruger I loved. I'm a dog person. You probably hear my dogs running around in the studio right now. But the Sentai version was kind of like a team mascot. Like it was just like a felt head with like a, you know, mouth that moved, like there was someone pulling the string. I felt the overall design and direction was cool, but I didn't want that head in my show. So I offered to construct my own version of the head at my special effects shop. In silhouette, they probably look very, very similar, but I wanted them to just be more realistic. So I went with kind of this reptilian dog creature, And I kept the blue, but I made it like more organic blues and not like fun fur blue. So it was heavily, heavily influenced. So I don't want to sound like I'm bagging on it. I loved what they did. I just didn't feel like when you're watching it, you were like, this is a living, breathing thing. So I wanted to put that filter on it where, you know, if theirs was the cartoon Doggy Krueger, I wanted to do the real Doggy Krueger.
What happened out there today?
Not sure what you mean, sir. I showed up, we kicked butt, end of story.
It may be the end of your story, but it's not the end of mine. You were late. You didn't answer your calls. Your fellow Rangers were...
All right!
Working with Doggy at first is very difficult because it's a talking dog. His head was remote control operated. So you'd be acting with this Doggy, and John Toohey, who played Doggy, was a great guy. Also, like a really, really good friend.
He's amazing. Like his voice and his... just the power, but the compassion that's in there just really connected Doggy Krueger to our dimension.
And you could barely hear him because it's muffled, and the mouth would just be like moving. And I remember the first couple weeks, it was kind of like, you know, cut, are you kidding me? I can't do this. But you know, eventually you get used to it.
I don't know, I think it worked out really well, except for the first day of filming. So one of the biggest issues is we shot SPD in New Zealand. And, you know, everything's different. The power, everything. And the crew, they are, you know, rock solid and amazing. They had just never really worked with, like, full-on animatronics before. All the stuff they had gotten from Japan for Power Rangers was, you know, all, like, very basic, like, rod-controlled and cable-controlled. And then you know, the guys that did have experience, like that had worked on Lord of the Rings and stuff, they were busy doing, I think, King Kong at the time. So this was kind of a new thing. And, you know, I was writing and directing and running around. So it was like, at first I was like, oh, I'll take care of the head. Wasn't going to happen. I had to hand it off. And, you know, in the end, they kind of changed it to how they wanted it to be and made it better than it could ever be. But on the first day, there was no one had any experience with that kind of thing. And the battery pack had been plugged in backwards. So it overheated and actually set on fire. And so it's like first shot, you know, do this big push in and the dramatic reveal. He turns around and he stands up and he starts going like, ah, and smoke's coming out. And I'm like, cut, cut. And everyone's panicking. And they get the battery out and it's all melted. And oh, it's terrible. And John Toohey, who was inside Doggy Krueger, he's not a man that you want to get upset. He is like a mountain of a man. But he was not happy about almost being set on fire. So we cut, and then all the, like, you know, because it was within the first week of shooting, so all the company representatives, like everybody was there, and they all like swarmed in on me, and they're like, what are we going to do about it? Like, this is a disaster, and we spent all this money, and we did all this stuff, and they're like, maybe we just take the head off, and it's just the guy. I was like, no. And they're like, well, maybe, like, how fast can you do a makeup effect? Because the makeup effect, because we had done on Grum and the other characters were makeup effects. And they're like, that doesn't seem to have, like, technical difficulty. Like, just, can you just make a Doggy? And I'm like, no, just let me figure this out and I'll make it work. There's just something that happens. So, you know, I had to convince them to trust me enough to rearrange the schedule. And what I did is I shot the rest of the day those same scenes, but all the reverses. I did all the Ranger coverage and everything just without Doggy. I think we might have even done like some over the shoulders and stuff. And I said, I'm just going to pick up all the close-ups of him as soon as I fix this. And so I stayed up all night and was on the phone, trying to figure it out. And figured out it was just like a voltage power thing and the things had been charged like without a convert, you know. We finally got him to work. So the Rangers had all seen Doggy Krueger on set, but had never actually seen him articulate. So a couple days later, we get back into the command center, and they're all standing around, and they're waiting for Doggy Krueger to bark his orders, and he turns, and he's like nose to nose with Chris, and he starts talking, and Chris just freaked out, and he was just not prepared for actual, like, a talking dog to be in his face. And it took probably about 45 minutes to get everyone back focused to finish the scene because everyone was just like crying, laughing.
Earth has become a haven for all alien races who come from the farthest reaches of the galaxy to live in peace. 99% of the newcomers live in harmony. But for the 1% who can't, there is Space Patrol Delta.
The main thing with SPD, when we decided that it was in the future and Earth was kind of a hub for all alien life, I said to everybody, guys, we need aliens. We can't be saying that these Power Rangers are the protectors of Earth and all the alien life on it if we have like one alien or two aliens, you know? I'm like, every episode I want new aliens. And everyone was like, you're crazy, you know? So they said, okay, well, we can squeeze out some budget. You can get like X amount of hundreds of dollars for aliens. And we kind of worked some numbers and I'm like, all right, that's like maybe 5 aliens. So like, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to make like 3 main aliens that we'll reuse all the time. And I'm going to take that other little pittance of money and spread it out. And I'll try and take on a bunch of the work myself and have at least one new alien every single episode. The cool thing about the guys that I was working with in the makeup shop was we do this job because we love it. Like, it's not a 9-to-5. We want to be challenged. We want to be as creative as possible. We want every possible opportunity to show what we can do and get it in front of the camera. So when they saw that I was willing to stay up all night and sculpt an alien, and, you know, they were like, we will happily mold it and paint it. And then they started staying up all night and doing their own, because they're like, wait, we could just make an alien and put it in the show? I was like, yeah, make 5, you know? So in the end, collectively, we ended up making 60 unique aliens for 38 episodes, which was a far cry from the original 5 that, you know, they were saying I could do.
Come in, SPD! Come in, SPD! We've been overrun! It's a trap! We're receiving heavy! What? Oh, now coordinates are 5.0!
Power Ranger fans are like no other fans on the planet. And I'll say universe, because I know there's some out there somewhere. And they're all really smart and really talented. When I decided to push for a woman Red Ranger, we knew it wasn't going to happen with the B Squad as our central cast, but I was like, please, please let me do it for the A Squad. Like, they're barely in the show, and it'll just be like a progressive thing showing that Power Rangers can adapt to modern times and women can be in charge. But I didn't want anyone to know. And part of it was because I wanted a big reveal, and part of it was because it wasn't 100% approved, and it was something we fought about all the way to the end. So in an early episode, we get a transmission from the A Squad, and that's kind of how we know that they're gone and B Squad has to move up and take over. I'm not really sure why we even did it, but we had a woman record the voice of Red Ranger. And then it was filtered through all this stuff to where you could barely even understand what they were saying anyway, never mind be able to tell whether it was a man or a woman. And it ended up being broadcast. And within hours, a fan posted on Ranger Board that Red Ranger was a female. He was an audio engineer and had recorded the show and filtered it and like decoded it and got all the way to the base recording and heard that it was a woman and put, and like, how is that even, but never in a million years would I even dream that someone would take the time, never mind that you could do that.
Let's take this to the big leagues. It's Zord time.
In the finale, we have A Squad come back, and through the Deca Ranger footage, the RB Squad has a Zord, and we didn't have one for A Squad. So, but there was a fight sequence that took place between kind of a generic Zord and a Megazord. And I said, well, you know what? Why don't we just make it where that was provided to them? You know, like they, maybe theirs got destroyed or something. But then we didn't rebuild a background for them, so it still had a SPD logo. And yeah, people just get up in arms that like that's not an official SPD Zord that they're battling in. And at one point, Bruce just wanted to rewrite the whole episode and restructure the whole thing. But I really felt on all other levels, it met all the needs to put the characters where we needed them and to put the action where we needed it. So I just pushed to go for it. And, you know, sometimes it's the executive decision. Sometimes you make good ones, sometimes you don't. I think as a whole for the show it worked, but I know it upset some of the fans. And I know, you know, publicly at so many conventions, Bruce just called it out and said he called me the director. Someone asked, like, why, how could this happen? And he said, the director wanted it that way. And I'm like, oh, okay, I see. So when I was directing the episode, I did want it that way, and I stand by it.
As you know, sir, my father was the Red Ranger. And ever since I was a little kid, I've trained for the day I become like my dad, the next Red Ranger.
Your father was the best of Rangers. If you're anything like him, we will all benefit by your service. Dismissed.
Thank you, sir.
Probably the biggest controversy at the end of SPD would be who is Sky Tate's father. Just to fortify the character, it made sense to Bruce and I that he wanted to be Red Ranger to follow in the footsteps of his father. You know, it's a classic story. Didn't really occur to us that the Power Ranger fans want to know exactly who would be that Power Ranger. And in our minds, even at that point, there was 13 years of U.S. Power Rangers. But that doesn't mean that was all the Power Rangers. Like, there could be satellite stories, especially in our universe, in the SPD universe. Like, it is one branch of many that are throughout. So he could have been from everywhere. But that was not an acceptable answer. Like, they wanted an actor that they knew from a previous season to be the father of Sky. And then I had gotten suits from, I believe they were from Turbo, and I modified the helmet. Again, low budget, trying to save money. So I was like, oh, I could just make a piece. I think the helmet looked really cool, but instantly they were like, that's Turbo. Oh, so his father's from Turbo. But then the timelines don't match up because that's technically the date. You know, so it's definitely a spider web. That's the one thing that I learned. If you jump into canon, you step off that line and you have to have answers. So it kept us on our toes. And, you know, it just made me love the show more because it's like better that than to work so hard on something that people don't even care about. You know, it was just love and admiration and, you know, just the drive that made Power Rangers and makes Power Rangers what it is.
You pay for this, Kruger!
Justice is served! Yeah!
Well done, doggy!
What really hit me recently is I have a 3-year-old son and I have a 4-year-old nephew, and my 4-year-old nephew last week had a Power Ranger themed birthday party. He doesn't really realize that I was a Power Ranger because it's a different season that he watches. And to go to that birthday party and to see it just was a full-blown Power Ranger birthday party and all the kids pretending to be Power Rangers and playing Power Ranger, and then my son putting on this Power Ranger mask and doing these moves and just being so excited to be a Power Ranger, I literally wanted to cry.
There's very few shows that go on when I did it for 13 years. Now it's in its 20th year. And that's a legacy. I'm part of something that there's only a handful of shows that can claim that they've been on TV for 20 years. And so I feel very honored that I was a part of that.
I am a part of history, you know, being a part of the Power Rangers franchise, and Power Rangers will never die. You know, when I was a kid, they were huge and they were exciting, and I feel like the franchise is just going to keep going on for many, many years, and it's such an honor and such a great experience to be part of that.
Now looking back, and it's still relevant and it's still part of my life, you know, it's an honor, you know, to know that, you know, my kids will one day be able to say their dad was the Red Ranger. I mean, that's how many, 30 other kids maybe get to say that? It's pretty cool. I'm so happy that I was able to be a part of it.
Now moving forward in a career as a director, the things that I learned about efficiency and story development and arc and writing and working with actors and different crews is something I could have never gotten in school. So outside of that, I think what I've taken away most of being part of this franchise and that season is that I now have some amazing friendships with some great guys and whose careers are going to skyrocket.
It was really good to work with a cast that, you know, not only did they memorize their lines, but they were aware of everything that was happening and how they could influence that. So we worked together as like this big family. And I think you see it. I think if you ran a marathon and watched, you know, 20 years of Power Rangers, SPD is kind of its own little satellite thing that sticks out and all just folds together. And it's just because the way that everyone got along and the vision we were trying to portray.
One of our rituals in the cast was every Thursday night, we'd all get together and go to Chris's apartment and watch Lost. And we were like, and that was when Lost first came out. And there's a quick clip of the Pink Ranger doing something in the show in the first season. I don't know if you're aware. And the Pink SPD. And I remember we were freaking out about that. We're like, we're kind of on Lost almost. Because I'm a huge fan.